They, I, when I looked over the video on regular expressions and pattern matching and check constraints, I noticed that there were some problems. I also noticed that moving forward, when we need to talk about foreign keys, the way things were defined was going to make things somewhat confusing and fairly difficult. So I redesigned all the tables so that you can see, and so it will be easier to set up the foreign key relationship between them. I kind of wish I had kept what I had done before, so you could see side by side comparisons, but I didn't do that. Because I didn't keep what I had before, but you will be able to look at the previous video, you can look at that and see what's different. I'll try and explain in this video and in the next video about why the changes were made. So in this video, I'll go over some of the changes. I'll also go through all of the different schemas and the tables, do a quick rundown about what's going on in the tables and why. And then I'll spend a lot of time looking at the check constraints, because you're already familiar with the other things in that, such as the unique default, not null. Okay. So let's get started. The first thing I want to start with is let's go to this schema and table I made called tax rates. And what I did is, you'll notice over here, what I'm trying to do is I made this, well, actually, I'll just run this first. Yeah, can't drop out because it doesn't exist. So I'll just do Control X. So over here and take that out. Let's run this again and hopefully it works. Okay. So I'll explain what's going on here and why I did this. You might recall that I had a table. First, let me just explain what's going on in this schema. I decided to make a separate tax schema because tax rates. I'll just explain the table and then you'll see why later. I decided to make a separate schema called tax, which will deal with tax rates for different states. That's all this. That's everything. So in this table schema, there's only one table. And you see over here, making that as just a state, then there's a rate, and then there's an integer, and then there's a surrogate ID. And I'm thinking I might make the state the primary key over here. Actually, I'll make them not unique. So if you look, and I'm using a sequence that we're familiar with, and I'm setting some defaults. There's a default tax rate, which is set to zero, right? And then there's a surrogate ID, but we've seen that before. And then I'm saying that the states must be unique, right? And the surrogate ID must be unique. States might all have the same tax rate or different tax rate, so that doesn't need to be unique. And over here, when we look at the check constraint, what did I do? I'm saying the rate has to be between 0 and 30%. That's all. And then there's also rate state. Let me change this. The state has to be in one of these. Okay. These are all the United States states and territories. That's all they are. And then there's a primary key, which we've seen, so let me run this again. Actually, I'll comment this out first. So a lot of this is familiar to you. And so I'll save that and I will run this whole thing again. Oh, come on. Drop table, drop sequence. Oh. Now let's see why oh dot. Tax rates. Sometimes this will happen, so I'll just do it this way. Execute, editor, and then just run the whole thing. What the heck? So you see, this is what can sometimes happen. I might have that in another. I'll search it. Instead of doing that, I'll take another look at rate surrogate ID. Change it. Oh, I think I know what's going on. Tax rate. So I'll save that. And I'm going to go. I'll drop that table. And let's. I don't think it. Yeah. I think it's tax rates or the ID. So it's probably being invoked somewhere else. I think I know where I might have to fix that, but I want to show you a couple of other things. I'm going to show you this other schema. So I have this thing called, let me comment this out again. Comment that out, cause, and tab that over and cut this Control X, Control V, and get rid of this line. And let me explain what's going on here. Okay, first, the reason why I'll explain what this is. You see, this is a te I have a snout a new schema called service, and inside here as a list of services that the company offers. That's all it is. Now, services are charged you a service you charge you there's going to be a rate, and then there's it's per hour. So you see, that's why the service is going to have a name. It's going to have an ID. It must have an ID. It must have a name. It should have a description. Okay, and there's an hourly rate. And then a surrogate ID. That's it. And then we have a sequence object over here. And then we're setting a default hourly rate to be, well, let's set it to be 25. Right? You see over here it's set to be two. This let's set it to be 75. The default is going to be 75 an hour, right? And the surrogate, we see that where we're getting a surrogate service, surrogate ID, DF, right? And then there's uniqueness. The ID has to be unique. The name has to be unique. The surrogate ID has to be also unique. Those are three things I care about, right? We would hope that there's going to be a description, but it's not going to be. But they might not have that. And then let's look at the check constraints. Now, the ID, we want someone to be able to. This is going to be the format of a service ID. It's going to have three letters followed by a dash, three numbers followed by a dash, an S, and a pound. So service IDs will have this format. And then you'll simply set the hourly rate between. Now you see over here, I set the default to be what, 75, right? So I'm going to set the hourly rate now to be between. Well, it's possible they might decide not to charge, right? So, in case they decide not to charge, let's say we want it to be between zero and let's make it 125. Okay, 0 and 125, right? And the primary key, we see it's on the surrogate ID. So let's save this and run it. Oh, I don't think I've done this yet. So I will uncomment the comments and run this again. There. So you see, this is working. And now I want to go to another schema to relate to service. So this is a product, because why is it that we have products and services? These are things that you can charge for. Your invoice is either going to have a product that you bought or a service that you paid for, right? So the product and the service table are very similar, okay? But products aren't charged, you don't have a fixed price. So let's look at this. So we have the schema, we made the products table. The columns are very similar to what we saw for the services, right? Only we have a price, there's no hourly rate, okay? And so that's also small money. And what, so we have a sequence object, right? And we've set the default price to be zero, okay? We could set that to be, well, we don't know what the price of different things might vary. That's why we'll set the default to be zero. All right. Could make it high, but let's just leave it at zero. And there's also the surrogate ID. And then what do we want to be? It's very similar to what we saw for the service. The ID name and surrogate ID have to be unique. We would like a product description, but it doesn't have to be there. Okay. The other reason, now if it's possible description, we can't say the product description should be unique with a check constraint. We'd actually have to go and check, look to see, make sure that they are not the same, which is a little bit involved. So now let's look. When we look at this, let's see the product ID. You see, product IDs are going to be in this format. They'll have PN dash, then a series of numbers between, three numbers between 2 and 9, and then what? Three letters between A and Z. Three letters. Okay, and the price has to be greater than zero. And then there's a product. So let's run this one. Oh, so you see, I already made this already. So what I can do is I'll just comment this out. And run it again. I feel like I just saved this. Yeah. Okay. So now you see that ran. And I want to look at the service again because I think I might have missed something. Yeah, that's small money. Oh yes, I did set the. So you see at this, it ends with S pound. The reason why I did that is people will know right away that they'll see product service IDs are formed differently than product IDs. They're the same length. Right? Actually, let me change this to if you see enough of them, you'll have an idea. These are three letters followed by a dash, three numbers. Okay. It's hopefully that's intuitive enough. Or maybe I should actually change this to be two. Let me change this to be 2 to 9 also. Because that way people will know. It's going to be, they'll never confuse I with when or L. Or they'll never confuse I, L, and when with each other, and O and zero with each other. Okay, so I'm just going to run this again. What's going on here? Oh, I have to comment out those comments. Then save it, run it there. And let's look at the invoice schema. So I have my invoice schema. It looks fairly different now. So there's an invoices table. And if you look at the invoices table, you'll see that there's a customer ID, there's an ID, there's a tax rate, there's a price, tax, right, total, timestamp. And then there's a surrogate ID, which is a unique identifier. Now all of this looks very familiar. You can see we have sequence.invoice. And we're using invoice price. We're setting all of these to be what? Zero. All of this looks very, very similar, right? So we're using invoice surrogate ID, default new sequential ID. And then what else? For the invoices, we're saying that the ID should be unique and the surrogate ID should also be unique. Those are the only two things that we need to be unique. Okay. You might recall in the last video, we saw that if we want to put the timestamp in there, it causes problems. So we can't do it that way. There's a way to do it, but involves using stored procedures. And that will take a little bit of writing. So now let's look at the check constraints. So we see that the ID of an invoice, which is what's going to be printed, is going to say SL. It begins with SL, like maybe sales, say SL may be short for sale, a dash. Three number, three letters, a space, two num, and then three numbers. Okay. So that's what it will have. So this is 10 characters long. You see, these are all formed somewhat differently from each other. And, Okay. Now the price, we're saying a price has to be greater than zero. And I've set the tax rate over here. You'll see later on, we're going to take all of this tax rate stuff out. And there's a primary key now. There's an invoice items table. Remember, last time we saw the items table, it was somewhat different. And the reason why I made these changes is that it's with this, an invoice, there's going to be a, remember on an invoice, there's going to be a row for each thing on the invoice. It's either going to be a product or a service. It's so much easier if we can just look up the services in a service table, the products in a product table, and then just put them in here. And with this now, so with that change being made, you see it, there's what? The ID, which is a unique identifier. There's a category. Okay. So the category, you'll see that later, but I'll tell you right now, it's either going to be service or product. And there's a product ID, quantity. So this is going to be the quantity of a product sold. And then there's a service ID, right? And there's a completion time. That's it. If it's a service, how long it took to complete. See, it's time. And then there's a charge for that item. I could have called this what? Invoice line items. But I think items is easier, right? And then there's what? A surrogate ID, and then there's an invoice ID. And the invoice ID, yeah, the invoice ID is card 10. And so let's look at what's going on here. So we have this, we made that sequence again, actually, but we're not using it because, oh, the surrogate ID isn't it, yeah. And over here we're doing, actually what I would like to do, no, this will be fine for now. We're not going to make, this is fine. I'm thinking what will happen if we have billions records, but this is fine. What we're doing here is we're now doing the default constraints, and this is a typo, it should be item ID. And item, yeah, the ID is unique identifier, so we say default new ID. And then the item charge, the default is zero. Item surrogate ID, we're calling out sequence.item. And then there's a service delivery completion time, where the default is zero, right? Because if we don't put anything in, we want to say it's not completed. We don't want to charge. And now there's a check constraints. So you see here, the charge is what? Has to be greater than or equal to zero. The item category check is either going to be item or service, right? You see that. So category has to be one of those two. And then there's item type. So if the product ID is null, service ID has to be what? If a product ID is null, that means what? It's not a product, it must be a service. So service ID, so the service ID shouldn't be blank. The completion time shouldn't be empty, right? And I'll also say that this, I'll throw in one other thing. And category is equal to service, right? Let's just do it that way. I could have done it a couple of other ways. So I'll do, now you see it's a bit long, so I'm going to do this. Right. So what I'm saying, if item product ID is null, maybe it's I think it's easier to read the other way. So I'll undo that. Okay, so it has to be, now the other one, if the service ID is null, the product ID must not be blank, the quantity cannot be blank, and category must be equal to product. So what you're seeing here well, I can take that away. And I only put the braces here because to make it easier to read. So you see it's doing everything. And actually, to make it even easier, I'll go like that. I'll go like that. And close that one, right? And I can now get rid of this. Close that up. Move that. So you see the internal there is no space. The external. Okay. So I've done that now. So what is it? I'm just saying that product ID is null. I could have also done something that I could have written this another way that if a category is, I could do something with categories. Let's say that the if is service and product ID is not. So, but this is fine. So you see what am I using here? I'm using an existence test that is null, right? Combining existence tests with just an equality. And then a last check constraint here is item completion time. So I set the completion time to be, it has to be between 0 hours and just before 24 hours. You see that? So you have 24 hours to complete the task. And then there's a primary key. So everything here looks about the same. And I think, so what I'm going to do now is I'll just save this and execute that. That completed successfully. I want to go back here, see what's going on with this. Maybe if I run it now, cannot drop sequence tax rate. I could find the sequences, but I think I could do it, but Okay, tax.rates, that looks right. I'll just do this. I don't fully understand it. Drop. I'll go to the message. Copy. Paste. Execute that. Oh, tax rates. Okay, I think I'm going to look at Object Explorer. Actually, what I'll do is, I'll do something a little bit odd. No, I won't do it, because it's taking away from this, and I don't need a tax rate table right now. I don't need it. I'm not going to need this till we deal with foreign keys. And then, so I'll forget about that and fix it later. Now, let's look at the customer. And this, you'll see a lot of stuff going on with check constraints. And the most interesting thing will be with emails. Okay, you'll see a couple of ways I did things. So now you'll see, remember for the customer, there's, in the customer schema, there's two tables. There's a companies and then there's a liaisons. And let's, the companies table hasn't changed that much. We have an ID. All right, set that to cart. 10, name, liaison ID, street address, city, state, zip, all of that stuff, website, email, phone, and then there's a surrogate ID. I have a sequence object. Let me write it like this. I think okay. And as a default constraints, we say by default, the phone number is none, email none, website none. Okay. But we also allow those to be blank, right? But we need some of these things. And then there's a company surrogate ID. Company. Oh, that's a typo. And then there's a unique constraint, right? The ID has to be unique. The name has to be unique. I'd say the street address must be unique. It can be in the same city, state, and zip, right? I didn't say the phone should be unique because we're not requiring a phone. Or website. And now the next thing I say here, and I could have thrown in something for the website. Actually, I think I will do that. So I will do that. But the website is going to have something with letters that ends with com. I'll set it that way. And I'll do that in a minute. So we say the email has to what? If you look here, this is fairly simple. It has to have at least one character, there has to be some characters before, at least one character after, right? Before an at sign, so at least one character before and then .com, right? It's very simple check. can still have malformed email addresses here, but it has to be in this format. And the cities, they should have, I'm saying it, there's probably going to be at least 3 characters or 2. At least 3. No city is going to have just 2 letters in its name. Most of them will have more than that. That's what I'm saying. It has to be, and it has to be all letters. And you see, there's no numbers in the name. Right? I should say, and city, not like. I could say there's no numbers in the name. I could also throw in that there. I'll throw in one more. And city, not like what? It cannot end in a number. See that? So the other way I could do it, which is simpler, is only letters. Let me do it like this. Until I don't want to do that, because I want to have spaces. So I want to have spaces. And I'll throw in So I'll just go back and say, let me undo that. Yeah, because the city might have spaces in its name. So you see it's getting a little bit involved. And then the company name, it's going to have, it's just to start with a letter and have a letter in there. Or it just can have letters, right? That's what you're seeing there. And then the E4 number. Now, this might look a little bit confusing, but I'm setting up so that... do you ever have braces around the error code, a space, the exchange, a dash, and then the line number? Or you have no spaces. I don't know why anyone would write it that way, but you might see it that way. And then some people like to use dots, so I just threw in dots. That was a free format. And now the state has to be one of these. And the zip has to be 5 digits. Okay? And the company ID, all the company IDs will start with C. They'll have a dash. There'll be 3 numbers. And then some letters, and a dash, followed by 3 letters between D and Z, because I did that because if a foot becomes of C, right, it just makes it less confusing, and then they all will have a pound sign at the end. So, and then we're doing, then there's a primary key. Now let's look at the customer liaisons table. So there's a customer ID, which is 10. There's an ID for the liaison, it's going to be a unique identifier. Okay. So I think I'm going to change that to be car 10. Okay. One reason why is someone might ask, what's your liaison ID? Right? So they want to be able to read that. It's going to be nicer to play with. So it's going to have a first name, last name, email, phone. And you see, because this person is a liaison for the company, they must give an email and a phone. And I said I was going to add something for the website. Let me do that up here. So I'll do that real quick. Company website check, and I'll say that the name must have website like. Let's do a very simple one to begin with. allow, it must begin with a letter, right? We allow could have a number in the middle. Can have a letter in the middle. It must have a letter at the end. Followed by what? A period, and then the TLD must have three letters. I could have said .com. I should say .com, because remember I said for the email it's .com, so. Yeah. And I think I'll cut this, Control X, Control V, right? So, and I think, yeah, that's okay. I'll leave it at .com. But now you see how I could make it A to Z, so it's any of those other Ds. But let's just leave it at .com. It makes it simple. And there's a liaison information coming back here. See, these are columns in the liaison table. The sequence, the default constraint. Oh, yes, I changed this ID. So it's not going to be unique identifier. So I will get rid of this. Right. And even though it's only one, but it's so long, I think I'll just leave it like that. And then what are the unique constraints? ID, phone, email, last name. We don't want to say first. Now, I left these here because we don't actually want to say people first and last name needs to be unique, right? We want to say the email must be unique. We also want to say that there's, I'm going to throw in something else, that we want one liaison per company, not two, right? So I'm going to throw in here also that the company liaison company ID _UQ unique. And the whole reason why we want that is someone can't represent two companies. We want one rep per company. We want one contact per company. So I'll do it that way. And now let's look at this. We saw the check constraint for the phone numbers already. So it's the same thing. Now let's look at this, which is a little bit different. And I did this differently so you can see there's many different ways you can write the check constraint. And this is all on email. What am I saying here? There's some characters we don't want in the email. So we see all of these. right? And I want to point out how I escaped the is what I want to point out. We also don't want a percent sign. And somewhere over here, where is it? You'll see it, there's a percent sign. But you know, percent means what is a wild card, isn't it? So we have to escape it. And I'm looking for an example where I did that. And you see also we don't want something else. I think this one has what? A space? Oh no, the space is over here. No spaces in emails, right? To escape, we don't want any single quotes. So you see I had to put what? Single quote for that, right? So this escapes a single quote. And I'm not doing so. I'll show you in the notes if I go to. Let's go into the notes. And there's an example in the notes of how you can escape those. So maybe actually go to. Okay. Hope I didn't take it out. It looks like maybe I did, because it's not. I didn't want to spend a whole. I didn't want us to spend a whole lot of time, but I'll show it to you. I have to look it up. I think I've forgotten what it is. I think it's percent, or it might actually be escape. So, escape, percent sign. Sequel. Escape wild card. Come on. Yeah, I thought it was. I think it's about, I have to put the slash. I thought it was. I'm going to transact SQL. So I'll show you. So I skip wildcard, transact SQL. I'll go here first. I think if I'm correctly, I might have an example. So you see that's a wildcard that we saw. Using wildcard like character. So you see, we could do that. We could do, you'll see an example of that. But I don't want this because I say if I want to say anywhere in there. Yes, I write escape. So you see over here they did what? Escape. So this is what I'm going to do. Actually, I could do it this way. This is so much simpler. I'll show you what I'm thinking of. Control C, and if it doesn't work, that's okay. I should have thought of this before, but I want to do or email, not like sent. So what's this saying? You see, it can't have a percent sign anywhere. Oh, actually, no, that won't work. I still need to escape it because it's going to think that there's going to be what? This break. So I still have to escape it. So I'll have to say escape. Actually, it should work because they said they showed it over here. See, it's that should work. Yeah, it should work. So I'll leave, and if it doesn't, then we fix it. But I don't think we'll see any emails like that. But I'm just throwing it in there. So these are all the characters that we shouldn't see in emails. Is that at a minus? No, we want to allow minus. We want to allow a minus sign. So I'll take that away. Because yeah, I'll take that away. Okay, this. Control V. Right. Or okay. So we're going to escape those. We don't want anything like any of these bad characters in there, anywhere in the email address. And this should be a dollar sign. I mean a percent sign. I think I've got them all. I'm hoping I don't have any errors. And see it as a space. Now, what's the other email check? Email bad. So you see, email shouldn't begin with a number. They should not have anything that's. I could have said, these are almost the same, but anything that's not a letter shouldn't be a letter. They must end, what else? They must end after the T, the last characters must be three num letters. If it's not, then this is, it shouldn't have any of that. Then I just commented all of this stuff out because I felt I might not need it, but I might take a look at it later. And then I the email good. So I say the email should be what? I'll just exp you can see this is allow all letters. So it begins with a letter, as a letter, and then as a letter at the end, an at, followed by what? Immediately a letter, something else, and then ends in letters. You might have domain names. Sometimes they'll have a number in them. That's why I say you can have a number in here, right? Allow a domain name to have a number, to end with a number. And allow a domain name to have a dash or underscore between its end, which must be a letter or number. So that's what you're doing over here. See, all of these are letters as a dash. And because underscore is a wildcard, I have to put it in between these braces. And then you see it can end with a letter or number, right? And now this is another part where we say the username can have a number in the middle or end, right? So you see this ends with a number. And then there's a number in the middle. And then sometimes people allow what they might have dots, dashes, or underscores in the middle. You can't have a dot, a dash, or underscore at the end of a username. So what did here is just allowing what? A dash, a dot. This is where it ends with a number, right? This is where it ends with a letter, right? And then there's an underscore. And I need to do one where it ends with, I'll go here, Control V, and change this to 0 to 9 and say or. Okay. And I made a note here in case I decide, I suspect that I could just take all of this and say it, something followed by what? Percent. Because all of these will do the other checking and it'll be easier to read. But you know, I said just leave it there. It doesn't hurt anything. I can test it later. So I'll save this. And oh, and then there's a name. You see names, only letters. I'll save that. Execute. Oh yeah, I probably don't have that in here, but I'm going to have to put it in. So you see, there's an ID. Company.companies. Oh, I call it customer ID. So I'll call it. Let me change this to company. ID, and that was car 10, and I'll say that can't be null. Okay, because we just want one rep per company. Now, I could do this differently, but I think I'll only do it this way right now. We could put in there, could have put the company rep, but I think this is good enough. So I'll save it again, execute, yeah. And that's it for now, and thank you for watching. Next time we meet, I'll talk about the foreign keys.